Hello students, in the last class we have completed microsporogenesis, how the pollen grains are formed. Today I am here to study the structure of pollen grain. So let us begin. Structure of the pollen grain. We know that this pollen grain is a male gametophyte. When we have dealt with its formation, now it's the time to dealt with its structure. So pollen grain is a spherical body. It is a spherical body, and to your wonder, let me tell you, it is a very fascinating structure. It displays arrays of pattern. How? The cell wall of pollen grain. The cell wall of pollen grain is called as sporoderm. The cell wall of pollen grain is called as sporoderm. Sporo means a spore type structure and derm layer. Okay, so the cell wall of pollen grain is called as sporoderm. This cell wall, that is sporoderm, it is divided into two layers. The first layer is called as exine, the second layer is called as intine. Again I am repeating, the cell wall of pollen grain is called as sporoderm. Sporoderm is not a single layer. It has two layers. The outer one, the outer layer is called as exine. The inner one is called as intine. This exine is made up of sporopollenin. What is this exine is made up of? Sporopollenin. And this exine composed of cellulose and pectin. Okay, intine is made up of cellulose and pectin, and exine is made up of sporopollenin. Now let us talk about both the layers in detail. The first layer, exine. Just now I told you that this exine is made up of a substance which is known as sporopollenin. Now, my question, from where this sporopollenin has come into existence? Don't forget, we have studied about Ewish bodies in Tapeter, right? Ewish bodies contains a sporopollenin. That sporopollenin is utilized here for the formation of exine in pollen grains. So what do we understand by this? Everything is channelized. Everything is pre-decided. Fate is already decided. So now this sporopollenin makes exine. Therefore, exine is a very hard outer covering of pollen grain. Because of the presence of sporopollenin, exine exhibits some special features. The first feature it exhibits is it cannot be degraded. Exine cannot be degraded. Why? Because sporopollenin is known as one of the most resistant organic material. Why exine cannot be degraded? Because it is made up of sporopollenin. And that sporopollenin is one of the most resistant organic material. That's why it hardened the outer covering of pollen grain. Now because it hardened the organic covering, that is exine, what happens? Exine is made up of sporopollenin, and because it is the resistant organic material, no acid, alkali, enzyme, temperature, pH, all these conditions do not have any role to play on this sporopollenin. Sporopollenin is not affected by any one of them, and therefore it is very much easy for us to prevent pollen grains in the form of fossils. We can preserve pollen grains due to the presence of sporopollenin on it as fossils or microfossils. Are you understanding? That sporopollenin is one of the hardest material, organic material. It makes up the outer covering of pollen grain. As a result, it plays some important role. The first role is it makes it hard outer cover, cannot be degraded, and we can preserve these pollen grains in the form of fossils called as microfossils. Hence, we can use them anytime later if we want to prepare or if we want to accelerate the possibilities of vulnerable plants. Am I clear with that? The next part. What else sporopollenin does? Because of the presence of sporopollenin, our pollen grains are well protected. When they are well protected, when these pollen grains go to different areas carried by various biotic and abiotic agencies. Clear with that? These pollen grains show a fascinating array of patterns. Okay? And these fascinating diversity of pollen grains is of taxonomic importance. It is of taxonomic importance. And over the pollen grains, there are some places where this exine is absent. And we call those places as germ pores. Are you getting me? That if exine becomes thin or is absent from some of the places over the pollen grains, those places are termed as pores, germ pores, if they are round in outline. But if they are elongated, we call them as germinal furrows. If they are elongated in outline, we call them as germinal furrows. Am I clear with that? The first layer is exine, made up of sporopollenin, which gives us many important points for the taxonomical benefits of pollen grain. It preserves pollen grain from the harsh environment. It preserves pollen grain and it gives us germ pores also. Now let us begin with the second layer. The second layer is intine. The second layer intine is a continuous layer. There is nothing like that it is absent somewhere or the germ spore. No, it is made up of cellulose and pectin. It is the inner wall layer of pollen grain, and this intine helps in the formation of pollen tube. This intine helps in the formation of pollen tube. So let us see the differences between exine and intine. Again, exine made up of sporopollen. Intine made up of cellulose plus pectin. Sporopollenin, hardest resistant organic material. This property is not exhibited by intine. Why? Because we have enzyme to digest cellulose and pectins. What are that? Cellulases and pectinases. Outer layer, inner wall layer. Exine is discontinuous and shows the presence of germ pores. Intine is continuous and germ pores are absent. Am I clear with that? This is all about the outer structure of the pollen grain. Let us talk about what is present inside the pollen grains. Now, let us begin with development of male gametophyte. What happens actually? This is our pollen grain, okay? As you can see in the diagram, this pollen grain is male gametophyte, if I'm not wrong. Having two outer layers, or having two layers, exine and intine. Inside you can see a well-developed nucleus, right? And the cytoplasm and a vacuole here. Okay, now this male gametophyte develops vacuole and the nucleus, and now this nucleus undergo mitotic division. As soon as the pollen grain's nucleus undergo mitotic division, there is unequal division. Unequal division of nucleus, and it results into the formation of two cells. The first cell is called as vegetative cell or tube cell. And the second cell is called as generative cell. Okay? What am I saying? I am saying as soon as the pollen grain is formed, okay, it undergoes division. Which division? Mitotic. That means we are talking about only the increase in cell number. We are not talking about chromosomal number. We are not talking about this. We are talking about this. Right? As soon as the nucleus of the male gametophyte undergoes mitotic division, so that mitotic division is an unequal division. Why? Because nucleus divides into a very large nucleus. And the cell which divides into very large nucleus is called as vegetative cell. While there is a very small nuclear division, okay, a part of the nucleus which is very small, the cell which contains that part of the nucleus which is very small is called as generative cell. This generative cell is a spindle in shape and it floats in the cytoplasm. While this vegetative cell is irregularly in shape, it is very irregular in shape, but it has or it is rich in nucleus. Right? A pollen grain, okay, exine, intine, nucleus. Can you see that? Now, if this nucleus divide, what will be the condition? The condition is like this, a irregularly shaped nucleus and a spindle nucleus. This nucleus divides. The irregularly shaped one is vegetative, the spindle one is generative. Right? So that means in a pollen grain, how many nucleuses are present? Two. How many cells are present? Two. So the pollen grain at this stage, at this particular stage, when in its cytoplasm two cells are present, the pollen grain is to be called as in two-celled stage. And to your wonder, let me tell you, 60% of angiosperms shed at two-celled stage. Means the anther dehisces out at this stage. Am I clear with that? But there is one more stage. And that one more stage is called as three-celled stage. What is three-cell stage? Let me tell you. This is a pollen grain, male gametophyte, tube nucleus, and generative nucleus. Okay, dense cytoplasm inside the generative and a lot of cytoplasm outside, so it's floating. Sometimes the vegetative cell plus generative cell is present inside the male gametophyte. And this stage we called as two-cell stage. But, and at this stage how many angiosperms? 60% angiosperms. exosomes are shed. But there are certain times when generative cell undergoes mitotic division and it results into the formation of two cells. And these two cells, which are formed by generative cells, are termed as male gametes. That means the smaller cell with the dense cytoplasm undergoes mitotic division and forms two cells termed as male gamete. So if in a pollen grain the condition is like this, tube cell, two male gamete, cytoplasm like this, right? At this stage, what is present? Vegetative cell plus two male gametes. The pollen grain is to be called at three cell stage. And 40% of pollen grains in angiosperms, they shed at this stage. Am I clear with that? Okay. Do you understand two-celled and three-cell stage? In the next lecture, I'm going to begin with megasporogenesis. For any queries, you can drop in the comment section. Thank you.